Hi folks, welcome to a new webcast on my YouTube channel. Today to be honest, I don't know what starts today. First of all, today I want to talk about a little bit infrastructure as code in Microsoft Azure. Especially, I want to talk about Bicep and what is it and how do we set it up and some basics. And then naturally, I think I will need some other parts. I don't know yet how much I will need, but some other parts for, in order to explain some more details to you. So why I'm making this is I consider the tutorials and, you know, the stuff you get online is pretty good, but I think a lot of people are pretty confused about where to start, what does it all mean. There are not so much sources which give you more context about infrastructure as code, Bicep, ARM template, Terraform, what is going on. So the purpose of this is, of this first part, is to give you an overview, to give you some startup procedures and some stuff you will need on your local machine, and to explain why all this is important. And I will have a simple example today too. So we will see how the creation of resources is different from other techniques like doing it with PowerShell or whatever. So, okay, to give you an idea what Bicep is, where it comes from, who is responsible, stuff like that, let me first bring up a little drawing I made. It is just, you know, it's a simple drawing. Let me show it to you. So what I want to show here is that Bicep is not so relevant at all, but it represents an idea, first of all. So there are two possibilities on a 10,000 feet view of the whole area you have in order to create resources in Azure. No matter what you do, there are some basic technologies you can't circumvent. Whether you see them or you don't see them, they are always there, which are the Azure Graph API and the Azure Resource Manager, which is, you know, the acronym would be ARM. And ARM is something in the Azure field you hear all over the place. So what we do basically is we decide in which way we approach those technologies which we need to use if we want to bring up something in Azure. So what's missing here, for instance, is the Azure portal. Well, the Azure portal is not different. It is in the left area. I'll explain the areas in a second. You have to think of the Azure portal laying somewhere here because you just use an UI, a web UI, in order to create resources, which means the Azure portal will simply use the Graph API. That's what I want to show here a little bit, just a quick drawing. So the imperative approach is an approach where you step by step explain the Graph API and in further processing the ARM, the Azure Resource Manager, what you want to create in which order. So you are responsible to, you know what you want to do when, because most of the resources are depending on each other. So you, for instance, can deploy just a simple virtual machine, let's say, or even better, an Azure App Service, because before you can deploy an App Service, you will need to deploy an App Service plan or to reference an existing one. So this is something you have to know. And the idea of imperative is that you give a step-by-step order list to the Graph API and to tell the Graph API to tell the ARM to do it in the right order. And you have to take care of all the stuff. Do it in the right order, not doing too much requests per time, because if you do it in parallel, for instance, you will get HTTP errors from the Graph API telling you, well, you are limited in the amount of requests per time, and so on. So this is an approach, I don't like it very much. It's not a bad approach, that's why he's not, you know, grinding. I'm kind of neutral because it works, okay? So you have Azure CLI, PowerShell, or whatever, maybe the SDK inside a programming language like C Sharp, the Azure SDK, and you hit it command by command. So instead of doing this, there is a declarative approach. There are many tools that do it, and Microsoft itself provides one approach, which is this symbol, which is called an ARM template. Well, obviously an ARM template somehow corresponds to ARM, and that is important because an ARM template is in the, if you will, natural language of the Azure Resource Manager written, and so it's kind of native. But it's pretty ugly. We will have a look at it in further doing, but believe me, it's pretty ugly. It's basically a JSON dialect. So to circumvent this ugliness, but to keep the declarative approach, some people thought about it, and for instance, Terraform, which is this one, came up with the idea, well, you know what, let's use JavaScript, stylish language for the user, and then we create the ARM template and take care of all the stuff which is complicated and ugly. So in other words, Zolus in regular are so-called transpilers, which means they are just languages coming with a tool set, Terraform and other stuff. And then you execute some command and magically they create ARM templates, which are ugly but native. And they just deploy them to the using the Graph API to the ARM, and the ARM will deploy the resources. That's basically what happens. Okay, that's why I like this approach, because declarative means you tell him what you want to achieve, but you leave it to the ARM, to the actual resource manager, in which order and how to create those resources. And you can tell him, you know what, I know there are some dependencies inside of my deployment and you can keep them going. There are a lot more advantages for declarative, but this kind of shows you the idea. So Bicep, this is the logo for Bicep, is simply one more transpiler, if you will, for ARM template. And Bicep itself, let us go to the web and say GitHub and Bicep, because that's where Bicep lives. And here you can see, this is Bicep. It's a domain-specific language. That's what DSL tells you. There are some pretty good explanations here, how you get started. I will cover all of this stuff too. There are samples and the source code is also here. So, and what's also important is that they deploy releases here. So Bicep is something you have to install on your machine. I will show you all of this stuff. Okay, so based on this, let's go ahead and check what you need on your machine, and I will tell you what you need here on a Windows machine, but it kind of is the same if you're using Linux or Mac or whatever. It will be the same, more or less. Okay, so let me head over here to my PowerShell. I will use PowerShell, Azure CLI somehow in mix. So, and what you need is, first of all, Bicep. Bicep itself is, I don't know, version, yeah, here you go. Bicep is a command line interface, or comes with a command line interface, and has, like every CLI has certain commands you can use. So, if you don't have Bicep on your machine, which means if you don't have Bicep dash dash version and there comes nothing, but you, I don't know this command, you have to head over here, go to the release, take the latest maybe, and download it. Here you have the downloads for the different platforms and bring it to life. By the way, speaking of Bicep and the versioning here, as you can see, 0.4 point something. So you could argue, you know what, this is a pretty pre-stage version or whatever. Turns out that's not the case. Because bicep 0.1 already took all the stuff which arm templates more or less could do, and arm templates is a pretty old technique, and just built upon of this stack a new version. And all this means with the zero is that they are still in the progress of work, and they are not releasing 1.0. So this is pretty stable. I show you stable stuff here. I use it in a production environment. You don't have to worry about the reliability here, because it uses, on the basis, it uses ARM templates. You can think of Bicep for ARM templates as kind of the same like TypeScript for JavaScript. So it's a transpiler to a domain-specific language, whatever, and that's it. Okay, so first prerequisite is Bicep CLI on your machine. Cool. Next prerequisite will be either the Azure CLI, so if you hit AZ, you should get something. Either the Azure CLI, or you get something like get module. And you see, I don't have it here. You should have this module, if you use PowerShell, imported, which is PowerShell AZ. If you don't have the AZ module installed, it's pretty easy. It's instead of import module, it will be install module inside of PowerShell, and it will get you all the needed modules. And basically, you then have to do the connect AZ account and whatever, or use Azure CLI, whatever. I will do a mix today of Azure CLI and PowerShell. You will see this. Okay, cool. The last thing now, the third and last thing you will need is you need an editor for Bicep, because, you know, you could write it in a notepad or whatever, but as you might guess already, Visual Studio Code, because of its extensibility, is a pretty good editor for it. So not the bare level Visual Studio Code, but if you have one, you can go to the extensions here, and then you can hit to the Bicep language support for Visual Studio, which comes from Microsoft. You just install it, and then you have Bicep language support. Okay, cool. So with that, let's get started here. So let's get started by creating a new file, and let's call it our test Bicep. By the way, another thing, I will share my code on GitHub. I will paste the link at the bottom in the comment section of the video, so you can see it. Let me zoom a little bit. Okay, so what's all about Bicep? The first thing we need to talk about is that you get complete IntelliSense. So if you hit control space, you get a lot of, you know, help from Visual Studio Code, from the Bicep extension, basically, and you get a lot of help, but you need to know where to start. So a good starting point for each Bicep file is to define the target scope. There are, I think, 4 target scopes available. Yeah, they are. And I have to explain what this means. So if you're a little bit familiar with Azure, which is not so bad for this webcast, you will recognize those terms. So let's start with the lowest one, with tenant. So what this means, if I would hit this, what I'm saying here is that everything I'm defining here at the bottom should be deployed directly beneath the tenant. So there are not many things you can deploy in a tenant. One thing you can deploy in a tenant, for instance, is a subscription. And let me explain that by just showing you maybe a little visual. I just recognize that it should be easier to understand this target scope thing. Let me write here target scope, so that, what is it? In order to understand the target scope, it is good to understand some Azure things. So the first thing in Azure you have, and you will, every Azure environment has this, is, I will show it in this symbol, This is an Azure AD or a tenant, or it's called directory, whatever. This is the tenant in Azure. Let me show you this in the Azure portal maybe. Let me just switch on my AZ mask and ensure that I'm on the right tenant. Didn't prepare this very much, but anyway. So this is the Azure portal, and the Azure Active Directory is your tenant. As you can see here, it has a tenant ID here, and my AZ mask is not working. But anyway, maybe I'll edit the video later. It should be hidden, but anyway. So this is your tenant, and it is the topmost thing which you can have in Azure. All the users live here, the groups. So this is identity management. This is also setting up things like mobile device management, external identities, and stuff, devices, stuff like that. Okay, the next thing beneath the tenant depends a little bit on. There are two things which can be in this order directly beneath the tenant, which is, first of all, I will show it with a square, this one. And then another thing could be, let's do a circle, this one. So what are they? And let me put here a dollar sign in here for a reason. You will just see in a second why. So this thing is, let me do a legend, because this thing will be a management group. Not many people in my experience know what this is, a management group. And it's pretty simple and straightforward. It is, if you will, a folder with which you can build up a hierarchy beneath your tenant, which is pretty important if you are a business. I'll show you that in a minute. And this guy is something you have to know. You have to have heard about this. It is a subscription. So the reason why I put a dollar sign in here is because no matter what you do, resources are always related to one and only one subscription. And every subscription is somehow related to a tenant. So let me explain. The first thing you could do, you could put a subscription directly in your tenant. It's not 100% correct, the picture I'm drawing, because there is one implicit management group which you can't circumvent. Let me colorize it a little bit different. Let me do something like that, because this is always there. And what you do, if you don't use management groups explicitly, you will use this thing, a management group which is always there and which is connected with the Azure AD. So this management group, and only one can exist of this type, this is called, now it gets a little bit weird, this is called the tenant root group. You can't delete it, you can't move it, you can't rename it, as far as I know, it's the tenant root group. So if you don't specify a management group for a subscription, it just implicitly, it is the tenant root group, and that's how a subscription is related to the tenant. Okay. The next thing you could do is, like you guessed it, you could say, you know what, I want to build a hierarchy inside of my tenant. Let's say this guy. And on each level of this hierarchy, you are allowed to put one or more subscription in. So what you could do here at the bottom, let's say, now it gets a little bit weird, but Visio comes in. You could say that this management group, which is related this way somehow, and you could say, you know, this management group and this management group and this subscription are in that management group. So why should you do this? You do this, if you are in a company, you could say, first of all, I would do a cost management on this management group, which means that the aggregated costs of each of the subscriptions inside the management groups are reported here, which is pretty important. If you have departments or a big corporation with divisions, you have the ability now to see the costs of your Azure of your complete Azure divided into your company areas. So that's the first important thing. The next important thing is what you can do is you can have role-based access control, so authorization, if you will, on the management group level too, and it will be inherited through this tree. So this means if you take this subscription and you say user A is contributor here, or let's say he's contributor here and reader here. So what you can do now is if you take this subscription at some later point and move it to this management group, without any doing, the user which has contributor rights here and thus here is now, you know, just a reader, because in this management group he's reader. So this inherits, and this is pretty powerful, as you might imagine. So now you know the term subscription management group. No matter what you did, if you use management groups or not, you end up with subscriptions. That's an important part. Let me maybe colorize subscriptions a little bit more, you know, more important, because subscriptions are the important stuff here from your perspective. And then the last thing which comes into play are resource groups. So let me find another form. Let's do this one and maybe let's give it another color still. So the resource group is something you have to know already. Resource group. No, that's not good. Let's do another legend item and say this is the resource group. A resource group. And again, this relationship is defined that a resource group can't live directly in a tenant, it can't live directly in a management group, it can only have one and only one subscription which it lives in, because that way it is ensured that the costs of the resources inside the resource group are related to a subscription. So this had nothing to do with Bicep at all. It's more an Azure, you know, hierarchy issue. But this helps you to understand what the target scope is meaning to you. So the target scope should be a thing you set up depending on what kind of resource you want to deploy. If you want to deploy a subscription, a new subscription using Bicep, which is possible, theoretically. By the way, I didn't do it at all. That's pretty rare, because subscription onboarding is different, but it should be possible. If you do want to make a Bicep file which deploys a subscription, the correct target scope would be tenant or management group, depending on where you want to deploy the subscription. Because that is where the new thing is deployed to. On the other hand, if you want to deploy a new resource group, you would use subscription as your scope, because the resource group is not deployed to a tenant or a management group, it is deployed to a subscription. And the last thing, and this is the most common target scope is resource group. I think resource group is also the target scope if you omit this explicit. You should not omit it. Okay, resource group means if you actually want to deploy something which is, you know, creating some value for you, like a virtual machine, a network, an app service, a logic app, whatever you do, you need to do it with the target scope resource group. Okay, cool. That explains the target scope. Another thing which is important, in one Bicep file, you have only one target scope. You cannot say something like, let's deploy blah, 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 and then you change the target scope to something else. It should give us an error, by the way. Yeah, because the thing says it cannot be declared multiple times in one file. So we will cover this later. Okay, let's imagine for now we want to deploy a resource group. And again, looking at our picture, we want to deploy a yellow one. If we want to deploy this, the scope must be subscription because we want to deploy it into a subscription. So let us change this to subscription. Okay, cool. We have a target scope. Another thing that is pretty convenient here, and it feels like it is like JavaScript right now, if I show it, let x be 10. And that's wrong, var x is equals 10. So this looks pretty like a programming language, but be aware. First of all, Bicep knows no line ending, because line ending in Bicep is enter, basically. So second of all, Bicep knows a lot of, if you say, I never tried this, is this possible? No, it has single quotes, by the way. No, you can change the value as far as I know. That's another thing. And if you have another type of value like an array, you can't define the array this way, 10, 12, 13, but you have, because it knows no comma. So what you have to do is enter all the lines. So all this is subscribed in the syntax elements in the Bicep documentation, but just to give you an idea. So you have a variables section here, not a section, but you can define variables. That's cool. We don't need it right now, I think so. So the main thing which comes now is you want to create the resources which you want to deploy. So if we are in a subscription and we want to deploy a resource group, the thing we do is, you know what, I need a resource, you tell it with the keyword resource, followed by some name, variable name, which is valid inside this Bicep template. This name which comes now has nothing to do with the name of the resource in Azure later on. Okay, that's important. So it could be, I don't know, Foxmoda, doesn't matter, it could be something. So let me say it is just group. And now if you hit space, he's coming in with something which is called the URI for resource provider, which means what kind of resource do you want to deploy? Because he cannot know right now. He does not know that you want to deploy a resource group. So you can type just here, like group or resource group. Oh, I misspelled it. Let me do it again. So here it is. A resource group is this. I will show you in a minute how you can maybe go a little bit deeper in this, in these URLs, because this is confusing in the first place. The next thing is pretty interesting, because you see something that you are maybe know this from APIs, and that's exactly what it's telling you. So what this is the versions of resource group definitions Azure knows, and this goes way back into time. Let me see, what is the oldest one? 2015, November 1st. So at this date, the first, if you will, ARM template version of resource groups came into play. So since then, there were a lot of releases Microsoft provided, updates, if you will, on resource groups, because every time the thing resource group in Azure got new options, a new API version was released. So the newest one is from April 1st of this year. So you define more or less, this is the thing I want to deploy explicitly. So, and then what you do is, and you say, you know what, how this should be defined. And the good thing with the extension, the next good thing is that it gives you IntelliSense here, and it tells you, you know what, if you want to, there's a macro, and I can determine the required properties for you, that you, so that you don't have to look into the documentation and in order to see what is required for a resource group. Let us do this, enter this. And he says, those are the two things which are required for a resource group in order to exist. Okay, let's go ahead. Now the name, now this is the name, the resource group which we are deploying will have in Azure. So let's do something like the sum test resource group. This is what I want to create. And the next thing is, in which location do you want to create the resource group? And one location could be Europe. At this point, you could also use functionalities inside of Bicep. For instance, there's a method called subscription, and because it's the method, it has rounded brackets. So, and what you can do is either you say subscription in the current context, which means if you will see later, if you execute this Bicep somehow and you want to deploy it, he's looking at the Azure context inside of your command shell to determine which subscription is currently selected. Be aware that this is pretty dangerous, or could be pretty dangerous. You have to control over this. Let me explain what I mean. So if I create a terminal here and I say az account show, which is Azure CLI, please show me to which account you are currently pointing. So this is a tenant I'm using, and I could do the following trick, because, you know, I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm always pretty bad in using this James path here. I can't remember how to type it. So what I do is something like this. I misuse PowerShell. Okay, let me show what I mean. I'm defining a variable, let's call it account. And I say az account show please as JSON. And then I say convert from, which is a PowerShell command, JSON, which is pretty sick. You know, and now what I have is, I have an object, and I can access the properties of the object, in my opinion, more conveniently. I don't know if you knew that. That's pretty easy. And now I could say, you know what, I just need the tenant ID, and there it is, boom. And you can paste it out pretty easy. And now you can see what's going on. I'm currently logged in with a user service principal. Oh, that's interesting, by the way. Let's see if this happened, if this works. Maybe I have to log in again. Account user is this one. Cool. Let's see. It's a good technique not to log into the Azure CLI or the AZ command with your actual user. But I think I'm not in the right authorization context. Let's see. So this subscription here means, if I execute this Bicep later in order to deploy this to Azure, that he takes exactly what az account show would return as a subscription. So this returns a subscription, and this has properties like the ID of the subscription or whatever. So for the location, it does not help, because a subscription does not have a location. But what you can do in later deployments, as you can see, you can use the resource group, which means, hey, the current resource group, and use its location, I think. Resource group, why not? It should work. I don't know why. Resource group location is something, but I don't know, maybe my thing, because it's in the context here. Okay, cool. So location will be a valid string, West Europe. What I know that my subscription I'm using here, this one, is enforcing tags. So it will tell any deployment which is not providing tags to the resource group that this deployment will fail. So I expect this to fail later on. We will come to this, back to this later. So as you can see, that's all. So the interesting part now is, you see, I have just one file in the folder. You can take a look at what this would mean for an ARM template if you just use Bicep, the CLI here at the bottom, Bicep build, and then we say test Bicep. It works, and then it creates a JSON for you. So if you look at this JSON, now you know why I said that Bicep is way more better than JSON. So what happens here is, And you can, let us be honest, you can take this away. So this is the same as this. It's exactly the same thing in a different syntax. That's basically it. So this is the ARM template for a resource group. Okay? I don't cover this ARM template much more. In this, I will take a look into ARM templates over and over again. In this syntax, but you know, it has double quotes, it has a complicated comma separated syntax, not complicated, but it's JSON, you know, and JSON is more or less to transport and define data and not to write a definition for something. This is more convenient, this is easier to write, I think. But what you've seen is by the fact that I, without any problem, can generate with one line, I can generate JSON, that will be exactly what happens when I deploy this stuff to Azure, okay? That's exactly what happens. So, what I have to do now in order to get this to Azure is I have to use some sort of command, and now I want to use PowerShell and not Azure CLI. There is a command for Azure CLI too, which will be new AZ deployment. So I already have it here in my history. Let's do it here. Okay. Location. I think I can omit location. Okay. So let me try. I don't tested it out in the step before I made the video. Let's just hit it and see what happens. And I'll explain later. So location. Okay. He needs the location. I don't know why exactly, but never mind, because we defined it here too, but it has to do something with this. This comes from Microsoft AZ. So, and it's failing. Let's read here that it's exactly what I told you. My resource group, and let me zoom here a little bit. I know it's hard to read. My resource group cannot be created because it's disallowed in that way I defined it by a policy. If you don't know what a policy is, never mind, it's just something you can put into Azure to have more control over how resources are generated. So if I go into my template and hit control space again, the good thing is he shows me now everything which is available at this level in my template, every keyword which is available. And macros here, for instance. And what I need is tags. So what tags is an object, which is shown me if I hit space here, he says you need to define curly braces now because it's an object. So, and tags here are, I think, just like a dictionary where I can say purpose is, no, I think that was wrong. I think that way, is that correct? Yeah, purpose demo, I think that way. So I want to have a tag which is called purpose and has the value demo. Let me redeploy this. Let me see if it works. Okay, it looks good. So let us look first using, now we use Azure CLI. AZ group show name is RG what was it, RG some test. So what's gonna happen? And yeah, here it is. There is a resource group. AZ group show showed me it, and maybe if I had OJSON, I'll get more information. Yeah, I see it has tags. And it is a resource group, and it was provisioned. It is laying in West Europe. Okay, with that, let's take a look here into my Azure portal so that you believe me. Resource groups, and then RG sum test. Let's see if this portal is already, there it is, RG sum test. And you can see my resource group, here is my tag, and it is deployed. So basically what this is doing, this command here, and let me just az group delete names sum test force? I don't know. Or I every time I forget, does not have or for, you see, I cannot delete this because I'm logged in as a read-only user. So let me delete it here, RG some test. And then later on, maybe I'll do another authorization, but anyway. Okay, cool. By the way, interesting that I can execute an ARM template deployment with my credentials, which creates resources, but I am a reader on my subscription. That is interesting. I don't know if I get something wrong here, but anyway, just keep it in mind. Okay, so in order to do exactly the same, and now I have to log in. Let me do an AZ login. And so now I will get an authorization with my user. You have logged in, cool. And now let's just let me wait here because there are a lot of tenants of my customer which will tell me, you know what, I'm a MFA tenant and I'm configured using Azure Lighthouse, which means those subscriptions are detected if I log into my tenant and blah, blah, blah. All kinds of freaking stuff going on and I don't want to expose customer data. That's why I just wait just a second. It's done. Okay, now I'm logged in. And now let me do exactly the same, which I did declarative here, using this command, new AZ deployment. Let me exactly the same with Azure CLI. It would be AZ group create, name is RG some test, and location is West Europe, which means I will get the error again. Okay, let me show you the error. There it is. It's the same, but you know, freaks out and tells me policy disallowed by policy, blah, blah, blah. Cool. So dash dash tags. And I think it was this way. Purpose demo. So, and now you get here the exact same thing. AZ group show name RG some test. OJSON please. And you see it's exactly the same kind of resource group. And now I should be able to delete this. Yeah, of course, because it's no, it's RG some test. Yeah, that will delete. Now my account is right. So that is what I wanted you to show. So one command, AZ group create, and then the exact same minimum properties like name and location, because without location, you will get an error if you try to create a group. Yeah, good idea, mister. So, and it's just the same thing, but, and let me do a deploy here. Here's one. And what this does is this new AZ deployment command. Let us put this here into this deploy PS1. And then if we are good people, we can do a clean PS1, which is AZ group delete name could have. So, and now if I'm just running the deploy PS1, it should create the resource group just like that. And then it could clean PS1. I could delete it again. So that's a good idea. So now we have some sort of good stuff going on. So the next thing I want you to show today, which is pretty important, is that you can parameterize your bicep templates. So for instance, this here, the name of the resource group is something that should come from outside regularly. So what you want to do is you want to say, you know, I have a parameter, param, and it's called name, and it is a string. And I think we can have max length, and we can tell him something like, you know, maximum of 15. You will see why in a second. And this is my parameter. I want this to be, should I have required? No, I don't need it. Okay, max length. So this is how you annotate your parameter, telling him, you know, it is as a max length. Because I don't have a default value like this, it is a mandatory parameter. I have to provide a value. So, and now all I could do is just say name is name, which is not so clever. Because the next thing bicep templates or arm templates at all can do for you is to bring something in that is very important for the governance of a cloud, which is naming conventions. So what you could do now is to say, you know what, I want this resolved name be a combination of RG dash, and then I think that way the passed in name. So what you see here is string concatenation, kind of, you know, leaning on to what JavaScript is doing with the dollar sign and stuff like that, but with all the backticks, it's just simply in the normal string, which is good. And now you can use the resolved name. So now we use a variable which depends on a parameter to create a resource name, but even more, there are more functions like toLower, which I like to use here, because what I want to say is, you know, no matter how he passes in the name, I want to do lower casing here, which is pretty important. So now what do I have? I have a variables, I have params coming from outside. Let's do it this way. Variables are calculated slash defined here. And then here comes my resource definitions. This is kind of all the way you do it. So now I have a problem. The problem is that I have to pass the name in. So there are several ways to solve the problems. The most elegant, in my opinion, is to create a new file, which, by the way, has nothing to do with Bicep. This is the same in ARM templates too. So let me create a file and call it parameters.json. It doesn't matter, it's just a JSON. And now let's see. I think that's the correct one, but you know what? Let me copy this out, because I always struggle with the format of the parameters file. I don't know what to put in. Let me just go into an existing project and let me just get it from there, so we spare some time. I didn't prepare this too, I'm sorry. Let me just create or get this one. And basically it starts with this thing. So this is the structure you saw, right? This is what I had here. So it just wasn't populated. So the schema and the content version. The content version is basically my versioning of this parameter file. Never mind. And then there comes the parameters section. This is JSON, as you can see. And the parameters section is a dictionary, not an array, which is something different. And now here I start to collect my parameters, okay? So what I want to do is, what was the name of a parameter? Parameter was name, which is not so good, but anyway. And this is an object, and I wanted to have the value of some test, I think. So let me see if I got this right. Let me compare this. Yeah, he's complaining a lot of stuff. I don't know why. What is he telling me? Can you please? Sometimes it's just, you know, messed up. You know, if I go out of this file, go in again, he's yelling at me. I don't know why, to be honest. I think he mixes up some stuff. Let us see if this works. So basically what I have is I have my template here, my bicep template, and I have one parameters file, which will be handy in different scenarios later on too. So what I can do now is for my deployment, where is it? AZ, new AZ deployment. There is a template parameter file property here where I can simply say, you know what, take the parameters JSON into account. When I omit it, let me just copy it out and first of all do it without. I think he should yell at me. Yeah. And he says, you know what, you need to supply the following parameters, name from template. So he's combining name with the string from template so that you know this comes from the bicep template. No, we don't want to use it because we already did the right thing and we said make a new deployment. This is where the resources are defined and here is the file which controls the parameters. Oh, parameter cannot be set because the parameter name template parameter is ambiguous. Template what? Possible matches include template parameter file, I think. That's what he wants. Here you go. So what should happen, it should deploy everything. That should happen. But let us see, it will. So now this is pretty cool, I think. That's the first cool thing. So what we got now is that we stretch out all of the stuff. We have the definition of resources separated from the actual data of the resources. So this template can be used to deploy a resource group no matter what, always doing it in West Europe and doing it with a purpose of demo. So this could be our template for a demo resource group in West Europe, no matter how it's called. So as you can see here, the name of the resource group should be, is it? I'm pretty confused that he's not telling me the name here at all. But anyway, let us refresh our resource groups list here and see if some test is there. You see, some test is here. So the name resolving did function. So if I go and say clean PS1 and we delete it again, let us see what happens if we do some weird stuff here, like this one, okay? So just ignore this, please. I don't know what's going on. Maybe select a parameter file from parameters JSON. None, please, none, still none. Oh, I'm always curious when I detect a shortcut and I can't remember what I did to get this window for the speech recognition. But that's another problem I have to face. Okay, cool. So my expectation is after this is deleted, I don't know. I have no clue why it is so that sometimes the creation here is weirdly long, the deletion. It has something to do with the feedback from the Microsoft Graph. I think the deletion itself is pretty fast, but the response, because this is an asynchronous operation, the response is simply not coming back. That was what I guess is going to happen, what happens. So it finished. Let us redeploy using our template parameter file. And again, to remember, I just messed things up here. So now what I expect it to be is that it's still deploying with the correct naming in lowercase. That's what I expect it to be. So now I can az group list. I think it's better. And there is some test, which is exactly what I wanted to have it. So now this should be the first part. So to cover things up, this is not imperative deployment, because what we say is we define the desired state of a resource we want to have later on in Azure. Not, we are not pasting in the exact commands to create the resource group as we saw on earlier. We just saying, you know what, I need this in this state, and please take care of it. The next good thing I'm cleaning already is that after I deployed this, I should not clean it. But oh, see how fast it was? Let me redeploy it one more time. I just recognize that there's some more pretty important stuff to tell you. Let me deploy it again. And let me az group show dash name ojson. So that is the state of the current resource group now, right now. So what happens if I add a tag? Let's say foo is bar. And I just simply run the deployment again. So this is interesting now. I like it very much, because what this does now is a so-called incremental deployment. So I will take a look at this in more detail. So let us take a look. So now I have two tags. So he didn't redeploy the complete resource group. He just added the delta. So what you could do too is, let me say X is Y. And now let me take my deployment here and add a parameter to it, which is, what if it's just this is a switch, the what if, and what it should do is, I hope so, it should create a list of differences between this template and the one already deployed in Azure. And this is pretty convenient. This had nothing to do with Bicep. It's already built in into the new AZ deployment thing. And what he's telling me here is that he is giving me something like a diff view in Git. And he says, you know what? I have a modify operation, color code purple here. I have a modify operation on the resource group, and it will add a new tag, which is called X will be Y. So this is something you can perfectly use in order to predict the changes you will make to resource group before making, or to resources before actually making them, which is pretty important. So let us just deploy without what if, just to see something. Here you go. You should do it, and let us az group show, and now X should be Y, exactly. And now what is what if telling me? Oh, damn it, I messed it up. Without what if, he's just doing it. And it, you know, if I cancel this operation right now, what? If I cancel this operation, that doesn't matter, because he already sent the job to Azure. So let me put it back in Y and do the what if. Yes. What we should see now is that he will have a change in modify operation to put the X back to Y because it's currently on Z. So pretty cool stuff. Yeah, tags Z back to Y. Perfect. Another thing which is pretty interesting, and I don't know if you already saw it, is I messed it up. Scott Hanselman would be pretty annoyed from this. Oh. Let me bring everything. That was cool. Okay. Let me see this one here, where my mouse is covering everything up. Anyway. What I mean here is, what is name deploy? What does it mean? Because I just did it without explaining it. So let us head over to the Azure portal to our resource group here. And for some strange reasons, this is not the correct resource group. This is the old one. Just refresh this, go here, and this is the correct one. So what you see is here are no deployments inside of this resource group. But later, on later tutorials, when we deploy stuff inside to this resource group, you will see deployments happening here. So, and what this is a name this will have inside here, the deployment name inside of this list. You can control this name using this parameter. That's basically the name you are giving it. So this is all for today. So I covered, first of all, some basics here on declarative versus imperative. And I hope you saw why I love the right side more than the left side. But still, the left side is completely valid. Okay, don't get me wrong. It's just, it's pushing some things like hidden champions in companies, because those persons exactly know in which order what to execute in PowerShell. They do pretty nifty stuff inside of it, but a lot of people don't understand it and can't reproduce this. And you are just faint here on this area that you know how to deploy something like a virtual machine. On the other side, this stuff aren't templates. They know how to deploy virtual machines correctly. They know all the parameters and stuff like that. And so this way you have like a lingua franca with ARM templates, and an even better and faster language using those transpilers, which you can use to directly talk to ARM in its native language, which I like. So then keep in mind that you need some stuff in order to bring it to work, like the bicep, CLI, and stuff like that. And to show you how well this is integrated, if you have the new AZ deployment script, take a look at this thing here, like at this item when I execute this deployment, and you see how it switches to bicep and then back to PowerShell, because what this shows is the current executable on this thread, I think thread or process maybe. So it, in a short amount of time, it, this command new AZ deployment recognized that I'm using a bicep file, because it was originally written for ARM templates only. And now it detects, hey, this is a bicep. And what it does is, invisibly for us, it creates or it executes bicep build blah 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 and deploys a JSON version. So this means, from the perspective of Azure here, from this perspective, ARM, there is no way that this bicep language ever hits this ARM layer, because he does not know bicep. He doesn't know what the bicep is for us, not for Azure. So the tooling will take care of compiling this to ARM and then presenting ARM to the Azure Resource Manager. And so there, this is the reason why we can use bicep 0.4, because it uses ARM template version, I don't know which version it has, but it is stable. Okay, if you have questions, feel free to post. I will take care that we have a follow-up pretty quick in doing more stuff. I hope it helps. See you.